this second part of lecture 3, we're going to look into fleet planning decisions. In particular, what are the factors that influence these decisions? The fleet planning process is highly influenced by cash availability and market opportunities. It is also a long-term decision process, both for manufacturers and for airlines. So for instance, the A320 family was firstly conceived in the late 70s, and the first aircraft was delivered in 1988. The design and production of this family of aircraft is still ongoing, and the first narrow version of this family was introduced in the market in 2016. But also for airlines, this is a long-term decision process. It involves a large capital investment. So we can be talking about 80 million for A320 or 300 million for A380. Also a long-term financial impact into the books of the airline. So the depreciation of a new aircraft can take 10 to 15 years. In terms of operations, the aircraft are in operations for a long term. Like, we still have airlines nowadays operating Boeing 747s, which were built in the 90s. So a decision regarding the fleet planning is not made every month or even every year. It's a long-term process. When analyzing which aircraft to buy or to lease, there are multiple criteria that are considered. Of course, that's performance of the aircraft is one of them, including the fuel consumption per ASK, the number of engines, the turnaround times that are needed to prepare the aircraft for to a new flight, the range of the aircraft, the capacity that it has. But there are also other aspects that are considered, like the comforts to passengers, the commonality of our fleet, environmental impact, also the type of markets and infrastructure in the markets that we want to use that aircraft. When looking at aircraft characteristics, one of the things that we look at is the relation between the range of the aircraft and the capacity or the number of passengers that can be flown with that aircraft. So in this graphic, what we are doing is grouping the aircraft types per family for both Boeing and Airbus, aiming at different types of markets in terms of range and pax capacity. It used to be the case that larger aircraft will fly the longer distance. However, this has changed in the last decades. Firstly, some aircraft have extreme ranges added to their capabilities, like the A340-500 and the 777-200 long range. Both not very successful, I must say, but they offer a large range. And the current trend is more towards smaller aircraft for long-range routes, like for instance the Dreamliner, the Boeing 787, and the A350. This plot also shows us an interesting difference between the way that Airbus and Boeing see the future networks, and in particular, in the existence of major hubs. So airline believes more on large global hubs, with trunk flights, with high demand being operated by large aircraft, like the Boeing A380. On the other hand, Boeing invested more on higher frequency networks operated by more efficient to engines and mid-sized planes like the Dreamliner and the 777. Despite the simple way that we represent this relation between range and the number of seats in one aircraft, we need to consider that this is not as simple. There is a relation between payload, that is the carrying capacity measured in weight of an aircraft excluding fuel, and the distance that that aircraft can fly. So the payload range diagrams tell us this relation, like the one that we do have here. These diagrams are different for each aircraft type variation. But they, although being different, they all follow more or less the same shape, and there are three key points in these diagrams. So point A tells us how further we can fly just by adding fuel until we reach what is called the maximum takeoff weight of that aircraft. After that point, the total payload can no longer be increased. We have to exchange payload, so the number of passengers that we are transporting, for fuel. And this is what happens between A and B. At point B, we reach what is the maximum full capacity of the aircraft. To fly even further, we need to remove weight and payload until we reach point C, and point C is the maximum range with no payload added at all to the aircraft. Usually airlines operate their aircraft in the range between point A and point B. Another important relation are the economic factors associated with purchasing or leasing a new aircraft. So airlines, to get a new aircraft in their fleet, they have to finance themselves either using internal or external sources, like cash deposits, loans, or equity. They also have to consider what are the costs and revenues of operating those aircraft in the long term. So upfront, they have to purchase the aircraft. They have also to consider having a spare part like engine and aircraft to replace the existing ones if there is a failure. They have to have ground equipment. They have to train their personnel. And they may consider to have second-hand aircraft being purchased or leased instead of new one. Second one is cheaper to buy but more expensive to operate. The two key factors here are existence of capital power to buy and the utilization pretended for the aircraft to be purchased. I'd say for low utilization cases, second-hand aircraft can be much cheaper in the long term than buying a new aircraft. But also fleet commonality plays a role here. So by having a common fleet, we can reduce maintenance costs and operating costs. It takes 27 days to train a pilot to go from an Airbus A320 to an Airbus A330. And there is also the economies of scale in maintenance, like the plot that we do have in this slide, where we can see that by adding more aircraft in our fleet, we can reduce the annual costs associated with noise, landing gear replacements in our fleet. As mentioned before, there's always a possibility to lease an aircraft instead of buying the aircraft. An aircraft leasing is a contract between the lessor and the lessee, such that the lessee does not own the aircraft, but can have the exclusive use of that aircraft for a period, given that it pays a specific amount during that same period. To lease an aircraft is a more expensive option than to buy it, but it offers more flexibility to the airline. That is, the airline is only bounded to operate that aircraft for a reduced number of years, typically 2 to 10 years. So it has higher flexibility to change the fleet and to adapt it to the market evolution. However, if we sum up the costs over the five, 10 years, and if you compare the leasing option with the purchase option, usually the leasing option is much more expensive. The lessor has to make a profit from this leasing act, of course. In addition, leasing requires less initial capital, but the airline does not own the aircraft, so it also does not benefit from a final sales income, which will be there if the aircraft will be owned by the airline. There is a current trend towards leasing aircraft, with aircraft manufacturers and major leasing companies offering this possibility to their clients. However, major all airlines always consider the option of buying their fleet. There are three types of aircraft leasing: wet lease, dry lease, and damp lease. The wet lease is usually between two airlines to respond to peak traffic seasons, a sequence of heavy maintenance checks in the fleet, or to initiate or to test new routes. It can also be used to be able to fly into states where the lessee is banned from operating. It involves leasing the aircraft together with the crew, maintenance and insurance, and usually takes about 1 to 24 months. Dry lease, on the other hand, is a long-term leasing. It goes from 2 years to about 20 years. So if it's between 2 and 7 years, is considered an operating lease, and if it's between 5 to 20 years, is a financial lease. The operating lease, the aircraft does not appear in lessee's balance sheet, while in the finance lease, the aircraft is considered as being part of the airline capital. With this, we conclude our discussion of the factors that influence the network and fleet development. So in the next video, we're going to look into ways we can model these both problems using a mixed integer linear programming. I'll see you there.